3 days passed, 3 nights passed. Inanna didn't come back. So her loyal minister, Ninshubur, set out to do what she had promised. She dressed in rags, like a beggar. She scratched her face, she scratched her thighs. She wept, she wailed, she lamented for Inanna. She cried out to the gods, "Please, don't let your precious silver be mixed with the clay of the underworld. Don't let young Inanna die." From the top of his tall black mountain, Enlil heard Ninshubur's cries, and he said to her, "Inanna was a stupid young girl. She went down into the underworld. How could she ever expect to return? Not even Ereshkigal can leave that place. Not even the queen of the underworld can do that. If anyone else were to go down there, the very same thing would happen to them, and what would be the point of that? Stop your wailing!" But Ninshubur didn't stop. She continued to cry. She wept, she wailed, she lamented for Inanna. And deep down in the earth, deep down below the ocean, deep down in the deepest well in the Absu, Enki, the god of wisdom, heard Ninshubur's cries. And when he looked up through the waters, he could see all the plants of the land dying, the flowers withering. Nothing would grow. The land was dry, barren, blighted. He understood that something must be done, but what? He could not go down into the underworld. So Enki took some dirt from one of his fingernails and he transformed it into a living being. He took some dirt from another fingernail and he transformed that into a living being too. The first one he called Kurgara, the second one Galatur, and he gave them the water of death, the water of life. He instructed them carefully. He said to them, "This is what you must do." And he sent them away, and away they flew like flies. They came to the great Gunsir Gate, the first of the 7 gates of the underworld. They found a tiny crack, like phantoms, they slipped through it. Then they continued through gate after gate after gate, all the way down to the dark land of no return. And there, in the darkness, just as their master had said, they heard a voice, moaning, crying, whimpering. They searched for the voice, and soon they found, lying on the cold, damp ground, Ereshkigal, the queen of the underworld herself. And she was in pain. Her pain was like the pain of a woman about to give birth. She wept, she whimpered, she said, "Ah, oh, my heart!" Kurgara and Galatur flew in close, echoed her words back into her ears. "Ah, your heart!" Ereshkigal continued to moan and cry. She said, "Ah, my body!" Kurgara and Galatur echoed her words back into her ears. "Ah, your body! You're in pain, dear queen!" When Ereshkigal heard that, just as their master had said, she wanted to give them a gift. The river at its fullest, the flowing water. But Kurgara and Galatur said, "We do not want it." "A field then," Ereshkigal said, "a field full of grain." But Kurgara and Galatur said, "We do not want it." "So tell me then," she said, "what do you want?" "We want the corpse that hangs on the hook." Ereshkigal looked at it She said, "That is the corpse of your queen. But it is worthless now, nothing but a piece of rotting meat." "It does not matter," Kurgaran Galatr said. "All we want is the corpse that hangs on the hook." So Ereshkigal gave them the meat. And quickly they sprinkled the water of death, the water of life, over Inanna's body. They cleaned away all the dust of the underworld, and Inanna was resurrected. Again, radiant with light, she stood up. She walked out through gate after gate after gate, taking back her mace, her divine powers, all the time growing stronger. And finally she stood there, right at the threshold of the great Gunseer Gate, just about to put the mighty Shugura crown back on her head, when a horde of demons appeared, surrounded her like a tall fence, and the seven judges of the underworld screamed. They said, "Who has ever heard of anyone leaving the underworld? Not even our queen can do that. Not even Ereshkigal can do that. If you, young Inanna, want to leave, you must find for us a substitute." And Inanna, surrounded by the demons like a tall fence, she walked towards her glorious city. And from the top of his tall black mountain, Enlil saw everything. Inanna resurrected, the demons surrounding her. He looked over towards her city, and there, in the House of Heaven, sitting on the throne, he saw weak, pale, suffering from his nightmares, longing for Inanna Dumuzi, her human husband. And Enlil looked back towards Inanna, and he thought to himself, "I will find for you a substitute." And with that, he sent 20 young courtesans to the House of Heaven. He sent 20 young courtesans to Dumuzi, and they brought with them scented oil to rub into his skin, a magnificent garment to wrap around his weary body, and they made him forget all his worries, all his cares. And Inanna approached her city. She approached the House of Heaven. The demons surrounding her like a tall fence said, "Well, Inanna, which one will it be? Who will you choose? Who will be your substitute?" Inanna looked. She saw Ninshubur, her loyal minister, dressed like a beggar, scratching her face, scratching her thighs, weeping, wailing, lamenting for her. She could not give her to the demons. She saw her servants, her musicians, all dressed like beggars, scratching their faces, scratching their thighs, weeping, wailing, lamenting for her. She could not give them to the demons. But then she saw, sitting on the throne, dressed in a magnificent garment, surrounded by 20 young courtesans, not weeping, not wailing, not worrying, not caring. There was Dumuzi, and she pointed her finger at him. She said, "How long would it have taken for you to even notice that I was gone?